today, I am excited to welcome Kirt Lewis as our guest speaker. Kirt, why don't you come up here right now? Kirt is from World Relief, which is an agency in Sacramento. Well, it's a worldwide agency, but they have a branch in Sacramento that works to aid in the resettlement of refugees in this area. It's a pretty amazing organization. Along with this, Kirt serves on the leadership team for the Refugee Highway Partnership, which is a global network of Christian leaders engaged in ministry amongst forcibly displaced peoples. Kirt has been a pastor for 16 years. He's a combat veteran and a husband and father of two beautiful girls. And he's also our Alex Wright lookalike preacher. So it's great to have him here. And I'd like to pray for him as he leads us in discussing the book of Ruth and God's heart for the foreigner. So let's pray. God, thank you so much for the work that Kirt is doing through World Relief here in Sacramento. And we just pray a blessing over that ministry and his work. And we ask, God, that you would speak to us through him this morning and as he opens your word. God, thank you for this story of Ruth and how she was welcomed into the family of Israel. And we look forward to hearing what you have to say to our hearts this morning. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, brother. I'll have to check on that. Maybe there is some family connection there. We have to research and find out. Well, good morning, church.
Good morning.
All right, it's good to be with all of you today. There is there's a rule of thumb in public speaking, a saying, I preached my first sermon when I was 18 years old, so I've been preaching for about 23 years, so you can do the math. And the rule of thumb says that you should tell them what you're going to tell them, and then you should tell them, and then you should tell them what you told them. And I'm going to violate that rule this morning, and intentionally so. I understand that you're in this journey through the scriptures, and much like any journey, as we travel through the narrative of the scriptures, we often don't know what to expect. What will we find around the corner? What will we see when we reach our destination? The story of the book of Ruth is so rich that it is impossible to mine all the riches it has to offer in this brief moment that we have this morning. But amongst those many riches, I believe that there is this pivotal moment in this story that reveals something about who God is, who we are, and what is essential for us to effectively carry out our mission as his people here on earth. It actually happens early on in the story, during the second chapter. We can call it Act Chapter 2, or Act 2, four-act story. And quite frankly, it's embarrassingly simple. Embarrassing in that it's so obvious, but often so missed or ignored. And I hope that when we get to the end of the story, that you and I will be reminded anew of just how essential and important this is to the mission that God has given us. More important than just understanding it, that we will live it. As I said previously, we don't have time to explore every aspect, but what I'd like to do is I'd like to start off by at least going over some basics of the story of Ruth. So, every story, as they say, is made up of three parts. You have characters, you have setting, and you have plot. And I want to look a little bit at those briefly today. Who's in this story of Ruth? Well, first of all, we have Elimelech. We have Elimelech, the husband of this family that's at the center of this story, along with Naomi, his wife. We also have Mahlon and Chilion, their sons. As the story develops, we'll add Orpah and Ruth, Mahlon and Chilion's wives. And then we'll also be introduced to Boaz, who is a relative of Elimelech. What's the setting of the story? We're told that from a time standpoint, it happens in the days when the judges rule. That's very important, so tuck that away, because we'll come back to that in just a minute. And then the story takes place in basically two places, Bethlehem and the nation of Moab. Bethlehem, kind of an important city, would you say, in the story of God's word? And Moab. What is Moab? Who is Moab? Well, it's important for us to understand a little bit about Moab and its history, particularly as it pertains to Israel, as we unfold this story this morning. A couple of things. Well, first of all, Moab starts, it's named after a person. Moab. Moab is one of Lot's sons. It's actually one of two sons that he had through an incestuous relationship with his two daughters. How would you like that to be the beginning of your family history? Your national identity. That was the beginning of the Moabites. You read about it in Genesis 19, 37 through 38. But we also come to see that there is a history of strife, of violence between these two countries. You can read about it in Genesis, or Judges, chapter 3, verses 12 through 30. There's not only bad blood, there's spilled blood. We read about it in that passage, and if I understand you all just finished the book of Judges recently, I think. You know the cycle of Judges? It starts with God's people compromising and giving in to evil, and then God sends and basically hands them off to another, places them in the hands of another country, another people, as a sign of his judgment upon them. They repent. God sends them a deliverer, a judge. They're delivered. And then they fall back into sin. And it's rinse and repeat. Over and over and over again. Might sound like our lives at times. In that particular instance in Judges, you might remember the story of Ehud, the judge who was given to Israel, and his assassination of the king of the Moabites, Eglon. And as the culmination of that conflict resulted in over 10,000 Moabites being killed. It's a lot of spilled blood in that relationship. And don't forget that this is a family conflict. And if there's anything that I've learned in my lifetime, is that there is nothing worse than a family fight. Amen? They seem to be even more, there seems to be even more vitriol in that kind of context. And that's what we see. Remember that Lot's uncle was Abraham. So you have this history that leads into this book, this story of Ruth. What happens? What basically happens in the story? You know, the short summary of it is this. You have a family. They're displaced because of economic reasons. Basically a famine. And they can't provide for themselves anymore. They can't find essential sustenance, and they have to leave, and they run to Moab. When they get to Moab, you find out that Elimelech dies. Shortly after that, some good news, that Naomi's sons marry Moabite women. I don't know, is that good news? Would that have been seen as good news? Moabite women. Do you think that was a popular decision on their part? Well, they marry Moabite women, and then what happens next? Naomi's sons die. You now have a household of three widows. Naomi decides to return. One of her daughters-in-laws decides to agree with her charge to go back to her homeland, but Ruth stays with her and returns. And in that context, Ruth meets Boaz. Let's look at the story here a little bit this morning. And remember, let's be on the lookout for something that I think is so simple but so essential. Chapter 1, verse 8. If you have your Bibles, you can open them up. We'll have some of the scriptures up here as well. What's already happened in the story is all of that, where they fled to Moab. Elimelech dies. Naomi's sons die. And she's deciding to go back. And then this is what we read, which we heard just a little while ago. Verse 8. Then Naomi said to her daughters-in-law, "Go back, each of you, to your mother's home. May the Lord show kindness to you as you have shown to your dead and to me. May the Lord grant that each of you will find rest in the home of another husband." Then she kissed them, and they wept aloud. But they said to her, "We will go back with you to your people." Think about the bond, the connection that formed in that time between them. Has anybody lost a loved one recently? I'm sure somebody in the room has. Intense connection that happens when you've lost somebody that you love. My mom passed away 8 months ago. And I remember walking through that context with my father. It's his 75th birthday today, actually. And my brother and sister-in-law and family. Intense. And there was a bond amongst these women. But what happens? Naomi continues. She says, "Return home, my daughters. Why would you come with me? Am I going to have any more sons? Who could become your husband? Even if I thought there was still hope for me, even if I had a husband tonight and then gave birth to sons, would you wait until they grew up? Would you remain unmarried to them? Unmarried for them? No, my daughters, it is more bitter for me than for you, because the Lord's hand has gone out." She saw everything that had happened as a sign of God's judgment. At this, they wept again. Then Orpah kissed her mother-in-law goodbye. But Ruth clung to her. Ruth clung to her. And that's when she says the things that we just heard earlier, but it's worth repeating. "Don't urge me to leave you or to turn back from you. Where you will go, I will go. Where you will stay, I will stay. Your people will be my people. Your God, my God. Wherever you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. May the Lord deal with me, be it ever so severely, if anything but death separates you and me." It's a powerful statement. Sobering as that is, I find sometimes the next verse a little bit humorous. It says, when Naomi realized that Ruth was determined to go with her, I think that was pretty obvious at this point, Ruth was determined to go with her, clinging to her, begging her, and she gives in. Okay, she stopped urging her. When they get back to Bethlehem, we read in a few verses, 20 and 21, that the people see Naomi coming. And what's interesting there is it says that Naomi was greeted. I kind of wonder why Ruth wasn't. I don't know. Is it just kind of an incidental detail? Maybe it was just left out? Maybe there was something there. But they focus on Naomi. And what's interesting is Naomi's response to them. They say, "Can this be Naomi?" Verse 20. "Don't call me Naomi," she told them, which means pleasant, by the way. "Call me Mara," which means bitter. "Because the Almighty has made my life very bitter. I went away full, but the Lord has brought me back. Now that's interesting. Is she empty? Did she come back alone? Did she come back alone? No, she didn't. Who was with her? How do you think Ruth felt when she heard those words? I came back empty. It's very understandable. All that she's been through, the grief, the despair. But do you think that those words stung a little bit for Ruth? She's right there. But Naomi thinks she's come back empty. Well, Ruth is an amazing woman, good and caring. And she decides after they return that she's going to go to work. gleaning in the fields to support her and her aging mother-in-law. Gleaning, for those of you who don't know, this is a practice mandated by God's law, whereby those who were harvesting crops were called to leave the crops found at the edges of the field to be picked up by the poor and the vulnerable of their community. It's basically public food assistance. It was Israel's version of SNAP, Supplemental Nutritional Aid Program, for those of you who are familiar with social work. So let's get this right. She's a Moabite woman, a foreigner, on public assistance. That's a popular position to be in these days, isn't it? We'll come back to that. So she just so happens to find a field. The field that she finds to work in is owned by Boaz, who is a relative of her father-in-law. And this leads us to the moment. This moment. This place where we can miss the obvious. The assumed action that is absolutely necessary for us to understand and to live out the mission Christ gave the church. Are you ready for it? Do you think you'll see it? It's the verse itself that seems pretty incidental. It doesn't seem all that important. Ruth chapter 2, verse 5. Boaz asked the foreman of his harvesters, "Whose young woman is that? Whose young woman is that?" What is it? What is the obvious and assumed action? The behavior that Boaz modeled, which is critical for us to understand our mission. What does this verse assume Boaz did before he asked the overseer the question? What do you think? Can I ask you? Who's got an answer? What did Boaz do? What did he have to do before he even asked the question? He had to notice her. He had to see her. Don't overlook the profound importance of that act. Something I think we would all agree about human beings in general, is they like to be seen. They want to be noticed, recognized. But you know what's interesting is that's not it. It's not only that he just saw her, but it's how he saw her. The rest of the chapter in the book reveals this. After the overseer tells Boaz that she is, emphasis, a Moabite, has asked for permission to glean in the fields, but it helped, probably helped, that she was with Naomi. Like, okay, she's a Moabite, but I said, let's go along with it. That's what the overseer says. Boaz goes to Ruth and says this in verses 8 through 9. Listen, this is so powerful. Boaz said to Ruth, "My daughter, listen to me. Don't go and glean in another field, and don't go away from here. Stay here with my servants. Watch the field where the men are harvesting and follow along after the girls. I have told the men not to touch you. And whenever you are thirsty, go and get a drink from the water jars the men have filled." It's interesting that he says, "I have told the men not to touch you, not to lay a hand on her." This comes up again in later on that same chapter, verse 15, it says, "As she got up to glean, Boaz gave orders to his men, even if she gathers among the sheaves, don't embarrass her." Later on, Naomi picks it up. She says to Ruth, her daughter-in-law, says, "It will be good for you, my daughter, after she had returned from the work, it will be good for you, my daughter, to go with his girls, because in someone else's field, you might be harmed. Why is that? What was it about a foreigner that most people saw? It makes me wonder, do you think that might be why Naomi was trying so hard to convince her daughters-in-law to go back? Was it that she might wanted to have spared them the humiliation, the second-class nature of their new home? Ruth's response just reveals this all the more. She says, at this, she bowed down with her face to the ground. She exclaimed, why have I found such favor in your eyes that you notice me, a foreigner? So apparently they were just somebody to be dismissed, hardly seen. And then listen to the response of Boaz. I have been told all about what you have done for your mother-in-law since the death of your husband. How you left your father and mother and your homeland and came to live with a people you did not know before. May the Lord repay you for what you have done. May you be richly rewarded by the Lord, the God of Israel, under whose wings you have come to take refuge. So let me ask the question, how did Boaz see Ruth? How did he see her? He didn't see her as a nameless, faceless category of people to be assumed as a threat or a burden. How did he see her? He saw her as family, referred to as my daughter. He also saw her as a woman of great compassion and courage. And lastly, that in light of all this, he saw her as worthy of the blessings of the refuge of God. That's a dramatically different way to see somebody. And it's transformational for our own lives. And the rest, as they say, is history. Don't we all long to see and to be seen for who we are? Perhaps who we can be in both this life and in the legacy of our descendants to follow us. Ruth would go on not only to be the grandmother, the great-grandmother of King David, but she would be a part of the lineage of our Lord and Savior, our King, Jesus. How do you see people? How do you see the foreigner? International student, immigrant, undocumented or not, the refugee. Did you know that just a short drive from here in Sacramento this year, over 3,000 refugees will be resettled in the Sacramento region? Maybe some will come to your neighborhood in the future. Or maybe you'll go to them. How will you see them? How will they understand how you see them? And what will be the resulting legacy you leave behind, all because you chose to see them the way Christ would have us see them? We've had the privilege of getting to know several people here from the church. I want to invite a couple of them up, a couple of your own, who have been engaging and working with some of the refugees. And I just want to ask them a few questions as we get ready to close our time this morning and have them share a little bit as well. Julia, share with us a little bit about your story and your interest in seeing our refugee neighbors.
Good morning. So my name is Julia, and this is Elka, and we are co-coordinators for World Relief at UCC. And I feel that God has uniquely equipped me for volunteering with refugees. My father was an immigrant. He came to the U.S. in 1959 from Lebanon. He was the first in his family to come to the U.S., and so many family members have followed after him that I can't even keep track of their names anymore. I studied Arabic a few years ago. I took 2 years of Arabic and absolutely loved it, and I didn't know why. I felt as if I was being prepared for something in the future, and now I know why I did that. I've been to the Middle East. I've been to Lebanon and Syria. I've actually been to Saudi Arabia. And so I'm familiar with the Middle East culture, and I know that the Middle East culture demands hospitality. And so I feel an obligation to welcome the refugees that are coming. And most important, I feel that God has equipped me with the Holy Spirit. From December, I took my first baby step, and I assembled a welcome kit with my small group. And from that time until right now, I feel as if the Holy Spirit has been preceding me.
Tell us a little bit about your journey here in the last couple minutes we have.
Yeah, my name is Elke Davison, and since I've been a teenager, I've always had a desire to help the less advantaged and the poor. And after we came back in Africa, I've been praying to see how I could help here, being in Davis, in cozy life, I have to say that, in comparison to a lot of other people in this world. And also being German, I watch the German news every day. It's my treat in the morning at breakfast, and I watch the news. And I saw, especially last year in August, when the Syrian refugee crisis really unfolded, and a lot of Syrian refugees went to Germany, Austria. I don't know if you've seen that on TV. And I felt like I'm so far away from there, but I really want to help here. And then I was really blessed that John Rainey stood up in October. He has a non-profit called Aslan Child Rescue, and he's helping right now the Syrian refugees in Jordan that are basically landed in Jordan from Syria and that haven't made it up to Germany and Europe. And so I had the privilege to go to Jordan last month. I was there for a week, and I visited a couple families, actually some more, and also a Syrian refugee family, and it was a similar situation like Naomi and Ruth. The mother had basically lost three of her son-in-laws through the war. So the three women with the families came to Jordan and stayed there. And I saw that what they actually had to lose through the war is really amazing. And then before this, before I went to Jordan, Kirt asked me to come on staff, only part-time to do ESL at Word Relief, and I'm organizing the English courses and English tutoring for the refugees here in the Sacramento area at for Word Relief. We're always needing tutors if you are interested in tutoring English. And my desire is just to share the abundance that we have in Davis, my family and I, and I would like to share that with the refugees in this area. They are quite a lot, and which I actually last Sunday, Friday, I sat with a Afghani refugee family in their apartment, and the woman was sharing a cup of tea with me, and I felt like it's like home, because that's exactly what I do. When you come to my house, I offer you a cup of tea. And so I felt that we were sisters. And so the refugees, no matter if they look different, they seem to be different, but in a lot of ways we have a lot in common.
All right. Well, tell us, what's the next step for some people here? God might be moving on their hearts. They want to explore a little bit more about how they can learn more and see what they can do.
Sure. So step number one, come talk to us. We're in the lobby. And I'd like to actually introduce Joy Justice. She's the church mobilizer. Joy, can you stand? She's coming back next week, and she will be teaching two classes on refugees in Sacramento. And you can learn how you can get involved. Those classes are at 9:30 and 11 next week, next Sunday, in room 111. And also, Becca, can you stand? I'd like to introduce Becca Brown. She attends ECC, and she's a caseworker with World Relief. You can talk to her in the lobby also.
And I think there's also some welcome kits that you want to
Yeah, the other very tangible way to help is through a welcome kit. If you go on World Relief's website, you can actually download it. It's a handout, and it will explain everything how to do it. But what you have to do it basically, it is we want to start a welcome kit drive today for the next 4 weeks, and it contains the basic household items the family needs to set up an apartment. So before the family comes, we basically furnish and set up the apartment completely, and you could be part of that. This welcome kit contains 5 boxes. There's a kitchen kit, cleaning kit, child and baby supply kit. So the families have a lot of children sometimes, and so they need supplies for that. Bathroom kit and a household kit. And there are 2 tangible ways that you could participate. One, you could pick up this copy in the lobby and bring it to your house, your Bible study group, or with your family. You collect the items and bring it within the next 4 weeks to the lobby, and then we'll take it to a Word Relief. Or you can basically pull up a tag in the lobby and get 1 item and bring it back to church in the next weeks.
Right. Thank you so much. Well, we're just inviting you to see people with different eyes. We're a little bit over, but we're gonna share and ask you to just go ahead and stand at this time as we recite the Reckon of Jesus.
Please read with me. Mighty Lord, as you guided the Israelites through the wilderness. As you brought the Israelites out of bondage to freedom.
Bring the refugees out of persecution to safety.
As you protected the Israelites through 40 years in the desert.
Protect those who languish for years in our refugee camps.
Wipe away their tears of sorrow.
That their mourning will give way to joyous hope.
Put an end to warfare and tyranny.
That some may return home without fear of violence.
Open the doors of safer nations.
Some may find new homes in new lands.
Rebuild their lives.
That they might enjoy the fruits of labors in peace.
Restore their material goods.
That they might sustain their families in prosperity.
Revive their hope.
That they might face a future of promise.
Surround all refugees with your heavenly host.
That they might know your protecting power.
Sustain them with your love.
That they might feel the warm embrace of love.
Strengthen their bonds of friendship and family.
That they might serve one another with encouraging love.
And inspire your churches to welcome a stranger.
That together in one network of communities of hope, for strangers become neighbors and friends and brothers and sisters.
Amen.
Amen. Church, this is what we're asking. I believe God's asking us to do. God saw you. God saw us for who we are, who we were in our brokenness. And he reached out and he saw us differently. And it's because of that gracious act of seeing us for who we could be, because of his redemptive love and his grace, that we have a future. Can we now expand that and see others the same way that God saw us? Church, can we do that?
Yes.
Can we do that? That's what we're being challenged to do this morning. Let me pray for you in closing. Lord God, thank you for your gracious act of mercy, your love that you poured out, that we recognize and celebrated even just recently, Lord, with what you did on the cross. And it's because you saw us for who we could be, result of your redemptive love. Lord, help us have strength and courage and compassion now, Lord, to look out and see a broken world the same way that you saw us. And may that cause eternity to change forever because of the lives that will be changed. We ask this in Christ's name and send us, Lord, in your blessing.